Good morning and welcome to our 9am online service from St Michael the Belfry. My name's Mike and I'm the curate at the Belfry and I'll be leading us through our service this morning. Now this morning we're starting a new sermon series where we'll be looking at selected psalms. And the psalm for today is Psalm number 1, which Matthew will be preaching to us from. We're going to hear from Walter, who's going to give us our reading, and our worship, our sung worship this morning, is going to be led by Kat and Izzy. So a big thank you to all those who have participated this morning. But before we worship together, let me open our service with the prayer for today. Holy God, faithful and unchanging, enlarge our minds with the knowledge of your truth and draw us more deeply into the mystery of your love, that we may truly worship you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. So if you're able, please do stand and let's worship together.
With thee through endless days. This is the first psalm. Blessed are those who do not walk in step with the wicked, or stand in the way that sinners take, or sit in the company of mockers. They are blessed who delight in the law of the Lord, and meditate on his law day and night. They are like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season, and whose leaf does not wither. Whatever they do prospers. Not so for the wicked. They are like chaff that the wind blows away. Therefore, the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the assembly of the righteous. For the Lord watches over the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will be destroyed. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
My mama always said that life is like a box of chocolates. You never know what you're going to get. So said Forrest Gump, and many of us know that's true. And this COVID-19 crisis has shown us that we never know what's just round the corner. Next week, next year, will we be healthy? Will we be ill? Will there be peace? Will there be war? Will it be a long season of relaxation and comfort, or a protracted time of trouble or crisis? In the midst of such uncertainty, how do we live? In changeable circumstances, what do we need to do to live well? Much guidance is found in the book located at the very centre of the Bible, the Psalms. They're written to speak into a breadth of contexts, including tough, difficult days. That's why we're planning over these next 7 weeks to look at seven particular Psalms that speak directly into our lives today. We hope you find them helpful, thoughtful, inspiring, prophetic. Today we're starting with Psalm 1. That's because it sets the tone for the whole book, setting out one key priority for the good life, for the contented life. Whether you're free to travel the world or locked down at home, Psalm 1 describes one key foundational thing that everyone needs to know if they're to survive and thrive in any situation. Now, to illustrate the point, the psalmist sets up a classic two-choice contrast. You know the kind of thing, philosophers do it when they tell you there are two kinds of people in the world, .. Advertisers do it when they show you someone struggling, perhaps in a certain situation, and then someone using their product, perhaps their gadget or labour-saving device, and all is well. Filmmakers do it when they set up a villain and a hero. Jesus did it when he talked about two types of builders, wise builders and foolish builders. Setting up this kind of contrast forces us to make a choice, which sometimes is very helpful. Which is it, this or that? And that's what Psalm 1 does. So what's the choice in Psalm 1? Let me describe, first of all, person 1 and then person 2, and it will become clear. Person one. Okay. Person one is a bit like you and me. They're on the journey of life. We know that from the verbs used to describe the way they live. This person, according to verse one, have a look at verse one, particularly if you've got a Bible in front of you. This person walks, stands, and sits. They're pretty active, on the go. They're living life. But from the start, we're not encouraged to be like this person, person one. Because this person walks, but walks with the wicked. Stands with sinners. Sits with mockers. In short, they keep bad company. But before we write off person one, I want you to see that the way they live has a certain attraction. I mean, if it didn't, why would anyone want to live like this? Think about it. Everyone is looking for community. Everybody wants someone to journey with, a people to journey with, a tribe to be part of. And person one has found that tribe. She or he has found a people to belong to. What are they doing? They're walking with the wicked. And that means going through life, ambling through life with those guilty of doing wrong. And that actually has a certain amount of attraction, because after all, we've all done wrong. And now there are people like us or worse than us who welcome us. Come walk with us, they say. For some, the community, the camaraderie of walking with such fallen folk is inviting. You have somewhere to belong. This person, person one, also stands with sinners. That's about standing tall, holding your head high, alongside people who've deliberately offended and hurt others. Rather than feeling bad about sin and cowering in their guilt, these people have pushed past their shame. There's no embarrassment, quite the opposite. Wrongdoing is championed. It could be terrible things like murder, sexual abuse, racism, or other forms of injustice. But it could be seemingly more acceptable sins like pride, lust, greed. Whatever it is, it's presented as normal, acceptable, certainly excusable. The boldness, the brashness of such sin for some can actually be very alluring. And person one also sits with mockers. They spend time listening to those who speak or write critical, negative words. Those who are bitter about others, who love to tear down rather than to build up. Such confidence, such cockiness is strangely enticing for person one, and indeed for many today. If you don't believe me, read certain newspapers or just scroll through your social media feed. Many of us spend time every day letting these negative, critical voices speak to us. We may not realize it, but often we're doing exactly what person one does, sitting with mockers and sipping from the cup of their verbal poison. What's the result if I live like this? The result, according to Psalm 1, could not be clearer. Look at verse 4. Keep doing this, and a fruitless and shriveled life, a dry and dusty life, is my destiny. The precise picture used to describe it is that of chaff. Chaff. Chaff, you probably know, it's the leftover bit after threshing corn is tossed up by a winnowing fork. The idea of winnowing is to be left with just grain, letting the chaff, the rootless, weightless fragments of straw blow away. That's the picture. When the sifting is done, chaff blows away. When times of testing come, there's no substance to person one. They just blow away. And when judgment comes at the end, which it will to us all, such folk, we read in verse 5, will not stand in the judgment. They won't have a leg to stand on before God, nor have a place, we're told, in the assembly of the righteous, which means they'll have no place amongst God's people. They will, as it says in verse 6, be destroyed. All this because of the company kept by person one. This is a great challenge, because most of us think we're independent people. We can spend time with this person or that person, or watch this film, read this book, visit this website, listen to this voice, and I'll be okay. I'm my own person. These things, these voices, they can't influence me. Really? Psalm 1 tells us something very different. Psalm 1 tells us they highly influence us because we're not independent beings at all. We're greatly shaped by what we take in. We're very much like person 1. Listen to the words of recently deceased Eugene Peterson. We are not ourselves by ourselves. We are born into communities. We live in communities. We die in communities. Human beings are not solitary, self-sufficient creatures. As we realise both the necessity and the nature of our lives in community, we also become aware of the difficulty, the complexity, and as Christians who are following Jesus, the seductions all around us to find an easier way, a modified community, a reduced community, customised to my preferences. Don't do that. It's a slippery slope. And let's take care what we take in. We're easily wooed by worldly wisdom, seduced by sugar-coated sin, captivated by clever criticism. Don't do that. There's an alternative, says Psalm 1, and that's found in the contrasting person 2. Let's look at this person. Person 2 still journeys through life, but is much more discerning about the voices they let shape their life. This person lets one voice above all others speak into their life. It's the voice of God. The voice of God. Speaking through what the psalmist calls in verse 2, the law of the Lord. Today we call it scripture, the sacred holy text of God's word. Person 2 has discovered that scripture is the key, the answer to the good life. Their life is shaped by the holy text of the Bible. This person we read in verse 2 delights in it. They look forward to reading it and listening to it. It thrills and it enchants. And as such, it becomes a very precious thing. Here in my study, in fact, on the other side of this room, is the oldest thing I possess. It's a Bible chest and it's nearly 400 years old. And it's got a date on the front, 1642. It was probably owned by a godly Puritan family at the start of the English Civil War. And in it, they would keep their most prized possession, their Bible, the family Bible, their precious Bible, the Word of God, the law of the Lord. And they would bring it out, no doubt, at least twice a day in the morning, first thing. So the first words they take in are the words of God. And last thing at night, so their final words they hear before sleeping were the comforting words of their good Heavenly Father. It's the same for the wise person described in Psalm 1 verse 2. They meditate, we're told. That is, they chew on, they reflect on, they contemplate and consider God's word. We're told they do it day and night, day and night. It becomes like food and drink, nourishing and refreshing like no other. What's the result of doing this? The answer is in verse 3. They are like a tree planted by streams of water. Person 2 becomes strong, sturdy, and steadfast. And unlike the fruitless chaff, their tree is quite the opposite, juicy, yielding its fruit in season, we read, for others to enjoy. Fruit for others. Person 2 knows they don't just exist for themselves, but to refresh and resource others. The tree described here has good roots going down into the ground, which absorb water, allowing the whole tree to thrive. This is the picture of person 2. This is the picture God has for you and for your household. Not fruitless, dry and blown away like chaff, but fruitful. Not failing, but prospering, even when drought comes, when hard, tough times come. And in the end, when God brings his judgment, which he will, what happens? Verse 6, rather than heading unbeknown along the road to destruction like person 1, those who love God and his word are not troubled by death and by judgment because they know that the Lord has, as it says in verse 6, been watching over them and will continue to do so. In fact, the picture is fair and consistent in Psalm 1. Those who ignore God and his ways and his word will be ignored by God into the future. But those who attend to God and his ways and his word will be watched over by God now and into the future. So, let's go back to where we started. What does this psalm, Psalm 1, say is the key thing, the foundational thing that sustains us in good times and bad times? The answer is God's word, God's holy scripture. That's why a person too delights in it and meditates on it, because that's the secret to satisfaction. That's the clue to contentment. That's the hallmark of happiness. It's all found in building your life on this book, on the word of God. This ancient, rich, life-giving text is what in the end brings hope and joy and peace and so much more. And here's why. Why? Because this book is all about Jesus. It's about Jesus. It reveals Jesus, who he is, who we are, and what makes life worth living. For many, a crucial text in this wonderful book is John chapter 3, verse 16. God so loved the world, that includes you and me, that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. And don't forget the next verse. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. What wonderful words. They remind us that God doesn't want destruction to be the destiny of any of us. He loves us. He loves you. And he wants us to choose carefully what and who we let influence our lives, our thinking, our dreaming, our loving, our very living. Rather than being taken in by unhelpful influences, he wants his word to shape all of us, all that we are and all that we do. So that becomes the filter for processing these other voices that are all around us. Surveys show that the average Christian spends no time or just a few minutes each day reading the Bible. No time or just a few minutes. But we spend hours listening to all sorts of other competing voices. Voices seeking to shape how we think and feel and how we're proactive and reactive, guiding our thinking about justice, truth, politics, sexuality, the environment, and so much more. Yet God is waiting for us with arms open wide, eager to speak to us from his word. He's ready every day, right here, right now, today, and tomorrow when you wake up. If we open up our life to him and allow his words to speak to us, then we will be changed. He has so much to say to us because he wants us to live well, to react well, even in these challenging times, and to live not fruitless, destructive lives like person one, but fruitful, prosperous lives like person two. Psalm 1 says, make your choice. Make your choice. Let me end by telling you a story. It's a true story. I think a very powerful story told by Carl Medieres in his book, Speaking of Jesus. It goes like this. I was staying with friends in Basra, Iraq, in the spring of 2003. While there, we managed to attract the curiosity of the hotel staff. They were curious about this team of international people staying at their hotel. Since a war was well underway, they were all the more intrigued because we weren't wearing camouflage and totting M4 carbides. During the day, out in the streets, we'd given out all of our texts, Arabic translations of the Gospel of Luke. We were checking in for another day and we stood in the lobby near the front desk. The hospitality manager leaned across the desk and looked at me. "Why have you come here?" he asked in English. "Are you with the American army?" "No," I said, "we followed Jesus to Basra. We're trying to find out what he's doing here." He took in his breath with a hiss. Isa? He asked, using the Muslim's name for Jesus. Isa is in Basra? We think so, my friend Samir said, and he wants us to help out in any way we can. The manager made something like a gasping sound and snatched the phone off the cradle. He rattled off a quick sentence in Arabic, hung up and came round in front of the desk. If you please, he said, stay right here. I know you must be very busy, but I had to call my brother. He loves to hear about Isa. Samir and I looked at each other. Isa was in Basra after all. Within a few seconds, three other men joined us, all in their 20s and 30s, wearing the dark blue uniform of the hotel staff. For a moment, I wondered if they were going to ask us to leave. Then one of the men, with black hair and a thickened moustache, rushed forward and shook my hand. He moved on down the line, shaking hands vigorously. His eyes lit up like candles. You know about Isa? He asked, returning to me. Yes, I said in Arabic. We followed him here. Oh my. His hand shot to his face. Let me tell you something, he went on. When I was a young man, a man came through our city and he was telling stories about Isa to the people. The rest of the group and the hotel staff moved close, listening intently. When this man left, he gave my father a cassette tape with recordings of the stories of Isa, the miracles and teachings of Isa, the people he talked to and how he lived. Wow, I said. Every night for 10 years, my father would play the tape for me and my brothers and sisters. He played it until the tape did not work anymore. He stopped for a second, caught his breath. I love these stories of Isa, and I miss them. Well, I said, he cut me off, excited. I've heard from my father and other men of the city. They say that there are books, saved books, ancient books that tell the stories of Isa as they happened by the friends of Isa. Is this true? Yes, I said. And as a matter of fact, we've been giving them out all day. He almost fainted. I could see his face colour, then pale, then colour again. He's vibrating with excitement. Oh, please, please, he said, as he gripped my hand. You must find one for me. You must give me one. I have to have one. All right, I said, and turned towards the elevator. I'll see if I've got one left. As I rode the elevator to my room, I realised that I was nearly shaking from the same excitement. He needed the stories of Jesus like he needed water and air, and I wanted him to have one almost as badly as he needed one. I tore my room apart. I ripped open my suitcases and threw my clothes all over the room. A shirt hung from the bathroom doorknob, a pair of socks stuck in the lamp. And finally, after scrambling around in my luggage like a miner digging for ore, I found one. A Gospel of Luke in Arabic. The title was something like The Gospel of Luke, a Follower of Jesus. I snatched it, raced out of my room and rushed for the lobby. I will never forget his face when I handed it to him. With tears on his cheeks, he held it reverently, slowly opened it to look at the print. He lovingly ran his fingers over the pages and then bolted for the lobby desk. He picked up the phone, dialing rapidly, and spoke even faster. When he hung up, he looked at me and said, I had to call my father. He will know if these are the same stories of Isa as I heard before. We waited for a few minutes, and after some time, an aging Iraqi man showed up, grey beard and all. He looked at us a little suspiciously at first and made his way over to his son, who was literally popping up and down with excitement. Papa, he said, Papa, these men have come here because they are followers of Isa. I told them about the stories of Isa on the tape and asked them if they'd heard of the writings of the stories. And they gave me one of them. The old man came closer, picked up the gospel, and lifted it to his face. He read the title, thumbed through the pages, pausing to read here and there, and then he stopped, lifted the book to his lips, and he kissed it, tears in the corners of his eyes. Yes, he said, this is it. These are the stories of Isa. He wrung our hands, hugged us to his body, so grateful that he shook. Isa. Jesus has given us his message, his precious word. Do you and I realize how precious it is? Folks, today, come to Jesus. Put your trust in Jesus and live by his word. Take it as your guide today and every day, especially in these 2020 coronavirus days. That, says Psalm 1, is the way of blessing. That is the way of life.
Great. Thank you for that, Matthew. Now we're going to respond in prayer in just a moment, but just to pick up on what Matthew was saying there about God's word and how it's so good to delight in it and to meditate on God's word. And for me, just to say that if you want to start doing that more, if you want help with that, then do join a Belfrey group and do go to our website to find out more about how to do that, how to get more into God's word, and with a group of people that can help you to do that as well. Because it's so important and it helps us to respond to to world events, to things that are going on around us that maybe we don't always have the words or know how to respond to. And we're going to pray about some of that now. So our opening prayer is actually from the Catholic churches in America have released a prayer about all that's been going on there across this week. So let's pray together now. God of justice, in your wisdom, you create all people in your image, without exception. Through your goodness, open our eyes to see the dignity, beauty, and worth of every human being. Open our minds to understand that all your children are brothers and sisters in the same human family. Open our hearts to repent of racist attitudes, behaviours, and speech which demean others. Open our ears to hear the cries of those wounded by racial discrimination and their passionate appeals for change. Strengthen our resolve to make amends for past injustices and to right the wrongs of history. And fill us with courage that we might seek to heal wounds, build bridges, forgive and be forgiven, and establish peace and equality for all in our communities. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So before we continue with our prayers, why don't you just take a couple of minutes to pray into that situation yourself? Maybe you know people who have been affected by it, who are caught up in it. Maybe you just want to pray for peace over that nation. I'll just leave a few moments to pause and to reflect and to pray. So as we continue to pray, let's turn our thoughts to this coronavirus, to the pandemic, to all that's going on in our country as well. And we pray first for our schools and our teachers and our students who have gone back to school this week. Lord, we thank you for our teachers. We thank you for our schools. We thank you that we live in a country where we have a school system. And Lord, we pray for your protection over all those who work in schools and over the students especially who have come back to school this week. Lord, we pray that as they come back, it would be a good and fruitful and useful time for them. Lord, we pray against fear. We pray against anxiety. Would you be in those places? Pray that school would be a place of joy and of learning and of security. And Lord, we pray for those who are making decisions. Would you bless them? Would you give them wisdom and insight? Would you help them to know the right paths to choose? Amen. Lord, we pray for our medics, for our NHS, for the doctors, the nurses, the scientists, and all caregivers. Lord, again, we thank you that we live in a country where we're so blessed to have an NHS, a National Health Service. And Lord, we pray again for protection over our doctors and our nurses. Lord, we pray for all those who are in hospital at the moment who are receiving care. We pray for those who are there for non-coronavirus related issues, and we pray for protection over them, that they wouldn't catch anything. And Lord, we pray for those who are in because of coronavirus. Lord, would you be with them? Would you be with their families? Would you give them peace and strength? Would they know your presence with them? And we pray for all those who have lost a loved one. Would they especially know your presence and your love and your comfort at this time? Amen. And Lord, we pray for our leaders and the experts. Lord, we pray again for great wisdom and guidance for those who are leading our country and who are leading all countries. Lord, I pray that you would give them such great wisdom that they would be able to listen to the experts, that the decisions they make would be for the good of those who have voted them into power. Lord, would you bless them? Would you guide them? Would you give them energy and refreshment? Father, help them to guide us out of this crisis, we pray. Amen. So let's join those prayers together with the words that Jesus taught us in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Well, we're coming to the end of our service together now. But having talked about being blessed and what it is to be blessed, we're going to have a short video now, which has drawn together some of those testimonies that were given in a few weeks ago for the 30 seconds of thankfulness. So do have a watch and give thanks.
I am grateful for getting to spend extra time with my son, including planting plants. Should we water them?
Yeah.
We're really thankful for Matthew and Sam Porter. Not only do they lead the church fantastically well, but our Belfrey group too have so much time for us during this time that we're in at the moment, and we're really grateful. Thank you.
I'm grateful that our son Christopher has been able to live with us here in York for the duration of the lockdown. He's been working from home here rather than being in his little flat in London on his own.
What are you grateful for?
My friend.
Yeah.
Something I'm so thankful for at the moment is the community that has been forming on my street. I've lived here my whole life, and for the first time people are starting to get to know each other. Everyone is helping each other out with groceries and gardening, and we've been having socially distanced barbecues on our driveways.
I'm also grateful for the government and for 80% staff wages. It's helped us at Coffee Bike hopefully get through all of this.
The thing that I am thankful for in this season the most is technology that's made it possible to stay in touch with friends and family near and far, and the ability to learn to play board games over video calls as well.
And I'm also thankful that we've been able to take in a teenager from York who needed a safe place to stay during the lockdown, and he's also living with us at the moment.
Hayley, what are you grateful for?
For getting to know someone new through the buddy system.
And I'm thankful for wonderful friends who drop off gifts, both in person and secretly, whether that's cake or Italian-themed deliciousness. Great. Well, I hope that that video has inspired you to maybe be a bit more thankful, to maybe give a testimony to someone you know about all that God has been doing in your life. And do keep an eye out, because we may well look at doing this again as well, and so that you can share your testimonies with us as well. As I said, our service is drawing to a close now, so just time for some notices. We have, of course, got our other two services today at 11am and 6pm. And the phone-in for the 9am service is now live from 9am as well. So if you know anyone that's been accessing that, then they can now hear the service much earlier in the day than they probably have been so far. So do try and let people know about that if you can. Do continue to look on the website. There are updates about our pastoral plans and the buddy system, the prayer list, all those kind of things. You can get in touch and sign up for our newsletter, and you can do all of that through www.belfrey.org. Again, I just want to say a big thank you to all of you who have managed to continue to give during this time. It makes a huge difference in how we're able to continue our ministry both locally and much wider as well. If you'd like to give, whether that's as a one-off donation or as a regular thing, then do have a look at belfrey.org/giving. And finally, we are going to be having coffee after our service as normal as well. So go to belfrey.org/coffee, and the password for this week is Peace 9, capital P, number 9. So it's Peace 9. We're going to have our final song together, after which I'll give the blessing. As we go out into this week, hear these words from Psalm 119. How sweet are your words to my taste, sweeter than honey to my mouth. I gain understanding from your precepts, therefore I hate every wrong path. Your word is a lamp for my feet, a light on my path. So may the blessing of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you now, and as you go out into the week ahead. Amen. Have a great week.